Around the World in 80 Days, by Jules Verne, Chapter 17, showing what happened on the voyage from Singapore to Hong Kong. The detective and Passepartout met often on deck after this interview, though Fix was reserved and did not attempt to induce his companion to divulge any more facts concerning Mr. Fogg. He caught a glimpse of that mysterious gentleman once or twice, but Mr. Fogg usually confined himself to the cabin, where he kept Aoud company, or, according to his inveterate habit, took a handed whist. Passepartout began very seriously to conjecture what strange chance kept Fix still on the route that his master was pursuing. It was really worth considering why this certain very amiable, complacent person, whom he had first met in Suez, and then had encountered aboard the Mongolia, who disembarked at Bombay, which announced at his destination, now turned up so unexpectedly on the Rangoon, was following Mr. Fogg's track step by step. What was Fix's object? Passepartout was ready to wager his Indian shoes, which he religiously preserved, that Fix would also leave Hong Kong at the same time with them, and probably on the same steamer. Passepartout might have cudgelled his brain for a century without hitting upon the real object which the detective had in view. He could have never imagined that Phileas Fogg was being tracked as a robber around the globe. But as it is in human nature to attempt the solution of every mystery, Passepartout suddenly discovered an explanation of Fix's movements, which was in truth far from unreasonable. Fix, he thought, could only be an agent of Mr. Fogg's friends at the Reform Club, sent to follow him up and ascertain that he really went around the world that has been agreed upon. "It's clear," repeated the worthy Silverman to himself, proud of his shrewdness. "He's a spy sent to keep us in view. That isn't quite the thing either, to be spying on Mr. Fogg, who is so honorable a man. Ah, gentlemen of the Reform, this shall cost you dear." Passepartout, enchanted with his discovery, resolved to say nothing to his master, lest he should be justly offended at the mistrust on part of his adversaries. But he determined to chaff Fix whenever he had the chance, with mysterious allusions which, however, need not betray his real suspicions. During the afternoon of Wednesday, 30th October, the Rangoon entered the Strait of Malacca, which separates the peninsula of that name from Sumatra. The mountainous and craggy islets intercepted the beauties of this noble land from the view of travelers. The Rangoon weighed anchor at Singapore the next day at 4 a.m. to receive coal, having gained a half day on the prescribed time of her arrival. Phileas Fogg noted the gain in his journal, and then, accompanied by Aouda, who betrayed a desire for a walk on shore, disembarked. Fix, who suspected Mr. Fogg's every movement, followed them cautiously without being himself perceived, while Passepartout, laughing in at his sleeve at Fix's maneuvers, went about his usual errands. The island of Singapore is not imposing in aspect, for there are no mountains, yet its appearance is not without attractions. It is a park checkered by pleasant highways and avenues. A handsome carriage, drawn by a sleek pair of New Holland horses, carried Phineas Fogg and Aoud into the midst of rows and palms with bright foliage and of clove trees, whereof the cloves form the heart of a half-open flower. Pepper plants replace the prickly hedges of European fields. Sago bushes, large ferns with gorgeous branches, vary the aspect of this tropical clime, while nutmeg trees in full foliage filled the air with a penetrating perfume. Agile and grinning bands of monkeys skipped about the trees, nor were tigers wanting in the jungles. After a drive of 2 hours through the country, Aoud and Mr. Fogg returned to the town, which is a vast collection of heavy-looking irregular houses, surrounded by charming gardens rich in tropical fruits and plants, and at 10 o'clock they re-embarked, closely followed by the detective, who had kept them constantly in sight. Passepartout, who had been purchasing several dozen mangoes, a fruit as large as good-sized apples of a dark brown color outside and a bright red within, and whose white pulp, melting in the mouth, affords gourmands a delicious sensation, was waiting for them on deck. He was only too glad to offer some mangoes to Aouda, who thanked him very gratefully for them. At 11 o'clock the Rangoon roared out of Singapore Harbor, and in a few hours the high mountains of Malacca, with their forests, inhabited by the most beautifully furred tigers in the world, were lost to view. Singapore is distant, some 1,300 miles from the island of Hong Kong, which is a little English colony near the Chinese coast. Phileas Fogg hoped to accomplish the journey in 6 days, so as to be home in time for the steamer which would leave on the 6th of November to Yokohama, the principal Japanese port. The Rangoon had a large quarter of passengers, many of whom disembarked at Singapore, among them a usual number of Indians, Ceylonese, Chinamen, Malays, and Portuguese, mostly second-class travelers. The weather, which had hitherto been fine, changed with the last quarter of the moon. The sea rolled heavily, and the wind at intervals almost rose to a storm, but happily blew from the southwest and thus aided the steamer's progress. The captain, as often as possible, put up the sails, and under the double action of steam and sail, the vessel made rapid progress along the coasts of Annam and Cochin, China. Owing to the defective construction of the Rangoon, however, unusual precautions became necessary in unfavorable weather. But the loss of time which resulted from this cause, while it nearly drove Passepartout out of his senses, did not seem to affect his new master in the least. Passepartout blamed the captain, the engineer, and the crew, and consigned all who were connected with the ship to the land where the pepper grows. Perhaps the thought of gas, which was remorselessly burning at expense in Savile Row, had something to do with his hot impatience. "You're in a great hurry, then," said Fix to him one day, "to reach Hong Kong." "A very great hurry. Mr. Fong, I suppose, is anxious to catch the steamer for Yokohama. Terribly anxious. You believe in this journey around the world, then? Absolutely. Don't you, Mr. Fix? I don't believe a word of it. You're a sly dog, said Passepartout, winking at him. The expression rather disturbed Fix, without his knowing why. Had the Frenchman guessed his real purpose? He knew not what to think. But how could Passepartout discover that he was a detective? Yet in speaking as he did, the man evidently meant more than he expressed. Passepartout still went further the next day. He could not hold his tongue. Mr. Fix, he said in a bantering tone, shall we be unfortunate as to lose you when we get to Hong Kong? Why, responded Fix, a little embarrassed, I don't know, perhaps. Ah, if you could only go all the way with us. An agent of the Peninsular Company, you know, can't stop on the way. If we were only going to Bombay and here you are in China, America is not far off, and from America to Europe is only a step. Fix looked intently at his companion, whose countenance was as serene as possible, and laughed with him, but Passepartout persisted in chafing him by asking if he had made such by his recent occupation. Yes and no, returned Fix. There is good and bad luck in such things, but you must understand that I don't travel at my own expense. Oh, I am quite sure of that, cried Passepartout, cried heartily. Fix, fairly puzzled, descended to his cabin and gave himself up to his reflections. He was evidently suspected, somehow or the other, that the Frenchman had found out that he was a detective. But had he told his master? What part was he playing in all this? Was he an accomplice or not? Was the game then up? Fix spent several hours turning these over in his mind, sometimes thinking that all was lost and presenting himself that Fong was ignorant of his presence, and decided what course was best to take. Nevertheless, he preserved his coolness of mind and at last resolved to deal plainly with Passepartout. If he did not find it practicable to arrest Fong at Hong Kong, and if Fong made preparations to leave that last foothold of English territory, he, Fix, would tell Passepartout all. Either the servant was the accomplice of his master, and in the case his master knew of his operations and he should fail, or else the servant knew nothing about the robbery, then his interest would be to abandon the robber. Such was the situation between Fix and Passepartout. Meanwhile, Phileas Fogg moved about them in the most majestic and unconscious indifference. He was passing methodically in his orbit around the world, regardless of the lesser stars which gravitated around him. Yet there was near by which astronomers would call a disturbing star, which might produce an agitation in this gentleman's heart. But no, the charms of Iota failed to act. To Passepartout's great surprise, and the disturbances, if they existed, would have been more difficult to calculate than those of Uranus which led to the discovery of Neptune. It was every day an increasing wonder to Passepartout, who read in Aoda's eyes the depth of her gratitude to his master. Phileas Fogg, though brave and gallant must be, he thought, quite heartless. As to the sentiment which this journey might have awakened in him, there is clearly no trace of such a thing, while poor Passepartout existed in perpetual reveries. One day he was leaning on the railing of the engine room, and I was observing the engine when a sudden pitch of the steamer threw the screw out of the water, and the steam came hissing out of the valves. This made Passepartout indignant. "The valves are not sufficiently charged," he exclaimed. "We are not going. Oh, these English. If this was an American craft, we should blow up. Perhaps, but we should all events go faster."